commit His Excellency, the Governor Charles D. Baker.
Thank you. Please. Please, you should sit. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Speaker, Mr. President, members of the House and Senate, fellow constitutional officers, Mr. Chief Justice, members of the judiciary, members of the Governor's Council, members of Congress, Senator Warren, Senator Markey, mayors, sheriffs, district attorneys, distinguished local officials, reverend clergy, distinguished guests, members of my administration, and fellow citizens. I want to begin by expressing my gratitude to some special people for the support and encouragement they've extended to Karen and me over the past year, to my cabinet and staff for their willingness to serve and their collaborative brilliance. Thank you. To the thousands of frontline employees in state and local government who make a real difference every day, the lives of our citizens here in Massachusetts, thank you. And for the people I've met, and maybe even taken a selfie with, thank you for sharing your stories, your dreams, your passion, and your encouragement. Now tonight, we're also joined by Corporal John Dawson's parents and Gunnery Sergeant Tom Sullivan's parents. Last year, both lost their sons in service to our country. Every man and woman who serves in combat is special, and their families serve right alongside them. Your presence reminds us what service, sacrifice, and loss is really all about. We are who we are as a Commonwealth and a country because of families like yours. And I know I speak for everyone here tonight and everyone across the Commonwealth when I say thank you and God bless. To the Speaker and the Senate President and members of this legislature, I want to thank you for putting partisanship aside and for engaging with us in good faith and good humor as we work to solve some challenging problems. And Dad, you and Mom, and my brothers, Joth and Sandy, have made me who I am today. Thank you. To my wife, Lauren, and to our children, Charlie, AJ, and Caroline, thanks for the support and love, because I certainly couldn't do this without you. And I still believe that the 40,000 voters who put Karen and me over the top in 2014 were actually voting for Lauren. Now, if I had to sum up the past year in just one phrase, it would be the following. Don't be surprised when you get surprised, because stuff just happens. Some good and some bad. 12 days after we took office, we determined there was a $765 million budget deficit to deal with, but thankfully it was 40 degrees out and winter was almost over. 6 days after that, it started to snow, and 9 feet of snowmageddon later, we had a transit system in serious trouble and a new term I'd never heard before, snow farm. Welcome to your new job, Governor, where your time may or may not involve the things you thought you'd be working on. Now, with respect to the T, some say in the Chinese language that the word crisis is composed of two characters, one representing danger and the other opportunity. The T's failures last winter became a crisis, and I'm proud to say that by working together, we found and we seized opportunity. We passed. We passed meaningful reforms, including the creation of a fiscal and management control board. And today, for the first time ever, we're having a transparent and reality-based discussion about how to improve the performance of this vital transportation system. Now, turning around a system with the troubles and problems that T has won't be easy or quick, and there will be some missteps along the way. But we are determined to do it. 1 million people ride the system every day to get to work, school, the grocery store, and back home. They need the T to work, and they need it to work well. That's why we're doubling our capital investment to the system's core infrastructure to $1 billion. And it's why $90 million was invested on strategies and equipment that will allow the T to battle whatever the curveballs are that are thrown this winter by Mother Nature. And to the taxpayers who may never ride the T, but who write a $1 billion check to the system every year, I say you deserve to know that your support is delivering a reliable, affordable, transparent, and efficient service. But 2015 wasn't all surprises caused by Mother Nature. At this time last year, our constituent services office was taking about 500 calls a week from people who couldn't get through to the health connector. For more than 2 years, getting and keeping health insurance had been a complete disaster for hundreds of thousands of Massachusetts citizens. Many ended up on MassHealth, and the state had no ability to determine whether or not they were actually eligible. This jeopardized hundreds of millions of dollars of federal reimbursements. Make no mistake, fixing the connector was a top priority. And today, open enrollment is mostly complete. More than 1 million people were redetermined for MassHealth eligibility. The federal government has recognized our work, and constituent services received virtually no calls. We were all aware of the systemic problems at the Department of Children and Families, which put Massachusetts at the bottom of most national rankings of child welfare agencies. The problems were laid out in great detail by the Child Welfare League of America's report in 2014. The report's author, Linda Spears, is now the commissioner of DCF. And thanks to her leadership, along with Secretary Mary Lou Sutter's, we are making progress. They're developing intake, investigation, supervisory, foster care, and in-home service reforms, some of which haven't been updated in years and some of which never existed at all. I want to thank you, Commissioner Spears, for your leadership of this critical organization. Thank you. Now, this is all being done in partnership with SEIU Local 509 Leadership, which represents DCF social workers. These workers often haven't had the playbook or the support from the top to do their work and do it well. Tonight, I want to thank Peter McKinnon and all of our social workers for your hard work on our behalf and on behalf of the kids of the Commonwealth. Children served by DCF are just like everybody else's kids, except they're among the most vulnerable. They need the support, love, and sense of security that most other kids have. Because let's face it, when you're a kid, there's really nothing more important than that. Now, over at the Registry of Motor Vehicles, segue. Long waits and long lines have been a frustrating, costly, and unacceptable experience for everyone. And if you get paid by the hour, it's been lost time and lost wages. I never expected we'd fix this quickly because it didn't get this way overnight. But creating a more customer-friendly registry has been a big deal for us. And while I'll spare you all the details of queuing theory, it's helped to essentially eliminate the hidden wait to get in the door and is allowing nearly 3/4 of customers to get in and out in 30 minutes or less, and we are just getting started. Now, working collaboratively with the legislature, we've closed more than $1 billion in budget deficits without raising fees or taxes. Instead, we tightened our belts, got creative and reduced spending, taking what was an unsustainable path and setting a healthy, responsible course. And working together, we've made investments in school aid and local aid. No longer will Beacon Hill balance its budget on the backs of local communities. That's for the guys upstairs. We focused on transportation, investing $300 million in Chapter 90 funding and hundreds of local and bridge projects across the Commonwealth. We increased the investment made in higher education. We invested $37 million in climate change and energy resiliency projects. We boosted support for MassWorks Economic Development Program by $10 million and launched a $3 million grant program as part of our urban initiatives. These projects breathe new life into downtowns, setting communities up for success. And we've signed community compact agreements with more than 100 communities across the Commonwealth, building on best practices and successful reforms. And in cooperation with public sector unions, we reduced our own headcount by more than 2,000, making state government more efficient without skipping a beat. And together, we're poised to make progress on a number of additional issues. The first is energy. Over the next few years, the region stands to lose about 10,000 megawatts of power as older generation plants come offline. That represents enough energy to supply Maine, Vermont, Rhode Island, and New Hampshire combined. Meeting our future energy needs requires cooperation with the other New England states, because the region's energy infrastructure and supply is closely linked. Our administration has outlined ambitious goals to reduce carbon emissions, and we have a plan to meet those goals through a diversified, sustainable, and affordable approach. But meeting our energy needs with renewable resources requires us to act now. Massachusetts leads the nation in energy efficiency, but that will never be enough. We have a growing solar industry, which we should continue to support, but not at prices 2 to 3 times more than every other option. Cost-competitive wind options are already available to us, and if advances in offshore wind technology bring a competitive price, we should embrace them too. But if we're serious about reducing our carbon footprint while maintaining a reliable energy grid and improving our competitive position, then we must significantly increase the supply of clean and affordable hydropower. Governors across New England, governors across New England, Democrats and Republicans, have made clear to me that they are ready to go. What they're waiting on is us, and any solution will take time to implement. I urge us all to act quickly to move on this critical legislation to this state and this region's future, economically and environmentally. Second issue is the epidemic of opioid and heroin abuse, which all of us have talked about before. The statistics are terrifying. 4 people a day are dying in Massachusetts. Prescribers in this state wrote more than 4 million opioid prescriptions for 200 million pain pills in 2014, and these numbers have been climbing for a decade. The rise in opioid and heroin addiction deaths has traveled hand in hand with the rise in growth in prescriptions. This is a real human tragedy. Moms, dads, brothers, sisters, and friends all tell hauntingly similar stories. It starts small. Fill this prescription or try this pill. But once someone gets too close to the flame, everything changes. It becomes the only thing that matters. People under the spell of opioids and heroin will do anything to get their next hit. Families and friendships are torn apart, trust vanishes, patience is overwhelmed, and tragedy is always inches away, and more often than not, it comes to stay because people die. Now, you all know I'm a healthcare guy. And I'll stand with my former colleagues when their clinical judgment is being improperly maligned. But not this time. Prescribers in Massachusetts and across this country are far too casual about the addictive consequences of these medications. Parents, teachers, and coaches don't know enough about opioids to protect their kids. And kids are mostly completely in the dark when someone says, "Try this." Now, we're close on legislation to enhance our ongoing efforts to improve prevention and education, to build on our intervention work, and to strengthen our treatment and recovery programs. Breaking the back of this beast will take time, creativity, and a willingness to be disruptive. Of course, we must be thoughtful, but we must be bold. Let's get this done, and let's not rest until we do. I also urge you to be bold on K-12 education. Now, I know for some, expanding the availability of public charter schools is controversial. But giving parents in underperforming school districts more opportunity to choose a better school is nothing less than any of us would demand for our own children. More than 40,000 kids, most from communities of color, are excelling in public charter schools. 37,000 more, mostly the neighbors of those kids, remain on a waiting list. Their parents struggle to understand why they don't deserve the same education their neighbors' kids get. They cry when they talk to me about the hopes and dreams they have for their children. And as a parent, I feel their pain. Parents want their kids to have a shot, a better shot than the one they had. And they see it right in front of them, but they can't make it happen. These are families that can't afford to move, and they can't afford to send their kids to private schools. This is their chance, and it's a good one. In Massachusetts, we're home to some of the highest performing public schools in the country, many of which are public charter schools serving low-income families and communities of color. Students attending the Brook Academy Charter Schools in Roslindale, Mattapan, and East Boston had higher scores on the English and Math Park exams than students in Carlisle, Belmont, Sudbury, Sharon, Concord, Wayland, Weston, and Newton. In fact, they had higher scores than students from every K through 8 school in Massachusetts. Now, we're willing to discuss, and we're willing to hear both sides. But a state that places such a high value on education should not place arbitrary limits on parents' access to high-quality schools. And we should not sit idly by while so many parents feel the pain of missed opportunity for their kids. Now I get that energy, opioids, and education, by Thursday please, are challenging and complex issues, but I believe we can successfully take them on. Over the past year, we worked together to expand and increase the earned income tax credit for 400,000 low-income families. Executed an early retirement program that will save $125 million every year. Enacted those dramatic reforms at the MBTA, solved two major budget deficits without raising taxes or fees, and provided a $28 million down payment to enhance education, prevention, and treatment services to beat down our opioid epidemic. And today, with your help, we are delivering on a promise that has eluded state leaders for more than 30 years. We will no longer send women who were involuntarily committed because of a substance abuse disorder to Framingham State Prison. They will access medical care at Shattuck and Taunton State Hospitals. Bravo. And later this month, we'll file a budget for fiscal 2017. And in keeping with previous efforts, it will increase local and education aid, continue our generous support for public transportation, and offer a number of important reforms in the way we operate. It will add money to the stabilization fund, and it won't raise taxes or fees. The people of this state live within their means, and we should too. We'll also be filing legislation that makes a modest adjustment to the film tax credit. We respect the legislature's desire to retain the credit. Mr. Speaker, message delivered. But we believe it would be more cost effective to return to its original structure and believe the savings from this adjustment could be directed to creating more affordable housing and an improved tax climate for Massachusetts businesses that sell products and services in other states. Now, in addition, too many jobs, good paying jobs that people can build a life and a career with, are going unfilled. We all know that. That's why our economic development bill will invest $75 million in our career and technical schools. Our proposal will make it possible for these schools to build more partnerships with local businesses and higher education institutions, and most important of all, serve more students. These schools are a pathway to a bright future. The skills they teach are widely in demand, and many of them are already well plugged into the job creators in their communities. In an age when too many people are struggling to find work that pays well, these schools have so much to offer, and we should help them make that happen. Now, as we end our first term, some have lamented how boring we are. And I must admit, that makes me smile. No fights, no yelling, no partisan scrums. I had a basketball coach in high school who was fond of saying, don't confuse effort with results. Work hard, but work smart. Too often in government, we confuse how much money we spend on something or how much we yell at each other about it with whether or not we're actually achieving any positive results. The guy who became the receiver of the Lawrence school system 4 years ago isn't a big talker, he's a doer. Jeff Riley cut his central office budget by 30% and put the money he saved back into the classroom. He renegotiated collective bargaining agreements to lengthen the school day and focus more on student performance. And he brought charter schools and traditional schools together to focus on the kids. He didn't get more money, he just did the work. It's an amazing story. The teachers, the kids, and the entire community are riding in Lawrence. And Jeff, I want to thank you and your team for everything you're doing on behalf of the kids in Lawrence. The reality is that citizens care about what we say, but what they really care about is what we do and what they see in their own daily lives. If they have a good job, their schools work, their local community is safe and thriving, and they can pay their bills, then they feel pretty good about where they are and where they're going. The reverse is also true. If they can't find or keep a job or get to one, if their kids attend an underperforming school, if they can't afford to pay their bills, if their streets aren't safe and their downtown is a wasteland, then no amount of good intentions or we're number one talk is going to mean anything to them. That's the reason why this administration is so focused on the blocking and tackling of government. It's where we can have the most impact on people's everyday lives. Now, all of us here get the campaigns or competitions, but governing is about the work. When Karen and I talked about a bipartisan approach to governing, we meant it. And when we talked about building strong communities and rebuilding the relationship between state government and cities and towns, we meant it. And when we talk about focusing on what works and what doesn't and doing more of the former and less of the latter, well, you know what? We mean that too. Every day, the people expect their state government to work. They work hard. They have to sweat the details, and they have to perform. So should we. Now, I have a plaque on my desk which contains the piece of scripture that I brought to the interfaith service we held just before we took office. It says, do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit. Rather, in humility, value others above yourselves, not looking to your own interests, but each of you to the interests of others. We live in a glorious place. Karen and I both say that all the time. And we marvel at the collective spirit, intelligence, and drive of the people of this great state. They are the reason Massachusetts is truly a leader in so many fields. Now, just last week, GE, one of the world's largest and most respected technology and advanced manufacturing companies, decided to relocate its headquarters here in Boston, Massachusetts. The competition was stiff, and everybody wanted GE as part of their innovation economy, but we were successful for a couple of reasons. First, there wasn't an inch of daylight between the Republican governor and the Democrat mayor, and the folks at GE could see we were in this together. Second, and most importantly, they saw who the people of Massachusetts are, what we do, and how the ecosystem we've developed can propel GE into the future. Now, Massachusetts didn't get here overnight. We got here over time. We looked at the big pictures, and we crushed the details. For decades, the people of this state have set the bar high and followed through. And because of all that, I can stand here tonight and say with certainty that the state of our Commonwealth is strong. But we still have work to do, and we always will. And as my dad has always said, success is never final. But I believe we have the will to collaborate, the shared sense of purpose, the deep belief that we can and should always do better, and the relentless spirit that says we must. God bless the Commonwealth of Mass, and God bless the United States of America. Thank you very much.